Y también está con nosotros por ahí atrás Steffi Smith. Hola. Ella es de comunicación de AMAS también. Y pues estamos muy contentos de que nos acompañe. Les repito, la presentación, cuando termine la presentación, tendremos obviamente preguntas y respuestas en caso de que alguien quiera hacerle sus preguntas a André, que está aquí con nosotros. Y también les agradecemos que al último nos acompañen a comer. ¿Sí? Gracias.
Gracias.
Thank you very much. So, my name is Andre. I am the CTO and the Executive Vice President of AMAS. This is my third time in Mexico. I was here twice already. Last time it was about 1.5 years ago, and I was actually presenting about AMAS. That was a similar event. And I just realized how much the company has changed. That I will be talking about some of these things, how we have evolved, also how the space has evolved in terms of security. It's kind of fascinating how fast the space is moving these days. So just 1.5 years and we live in a totally different world when it comes to security. So these are some of the things that I'll be talking about. So by the way, I speak English. If English is not good for you, then we have the simultaneous translation. So please make use of it. And if you have any questions at any time, I would actually like you to ask them, raise your hand or whatever, because it's better to do it at that moment instead of waiting, so no problem with that. And then I'll use you can ask the questions in Spanish because we have the translations either way. Okay, good. So let me start here a little bit kind of high level with our mission or what we believe. We basically see in the future there will be, advancements of technology, there will be new things coming and we'll be more and more surrounded by technology. At the same time, security is going to be very seamless. It's going to be very kind of unseen by typical users, and everything that we do and somehow that we create has this kind of credit that we want to create products that somehow people don't have to worry about, that is totally seamless and very simple to use. Let me start by talking a little bit about AMAS as the company and the numbers. So the company is actually not new. We were founded as early as 1988, one of the earliest security companies of its kind. So almost 30 years ago now. And we are headquartered in Prague, Czech Republic. I come from Prague, I'm Czech. The headquarters, as well as the management team of the company, is located there. We have about 1,600 people globally, 1,600, out of which about 1,000 are in Czech Republic and about 600 are outside of Czech Republic. The single largest location outside of Czech Republic is US. We have about 250 people in the US, mainly Silicon Valley. And then multiple locations across Europe and Asia also. We don't have any office in Mexico, but Mexico is a very important market for us. It's actually Latin America as a whole, from Mexico down to Argentina, is one of our key markets and one of our fastest growing markets. And Mexico today, is actually more than 25% of all the business that we have in Latin America. So good growth. One thing that really kind of I think differentiates AMAS from other companies is that we have an immense amount of users. That's caused by the business model that we embraced many years ago, the freemium business model, in which we basically distribute a basic version of the product for free, and then a certain percentage of our users eventually upgrades to paid version. And that's a model that is relatively common these days, especially on mobile. Most software applications are available as free, including games, including regular software. But it wasn't common when we started with it in 2001. It's actually, we were one of the pioneers of the freemium model. And we have been quite happy with it, and we believe it is the winning model in software.
if you look at the traditional competitors, if you look at most software companies, they are either switching to this model now, or they are, you know, having troubles because, you know, the power of the free user base as a distribution vehicle is really, big. Now, with freemium, we always say that the product has to be not only free, but it has to be pretty good also. Because people will not use a product just because it's free. It has to be good so that people can recommend it to their friends and can actually kind of replace their, you know, legacy products with the free product. And that's especially the case with security, where people, I mean, aren't in the mood of risking something, right? So we always kind of had the mantra of having a free product, fully competitive, and kind of up there on par with other people's paid products. Now in Mexico, we have been quite successful. Specifically, we believe we have about 50% market share in Mexico, especially on the PC. I'll show you some charts later, but we have about 13 million users in Mexico, which is obviously a very good number, out of which about 9 million on the PC. And that by itself kind of makes the 50% market share. One of the things that that was kind of milestone in our company history was the combination with AVG. AVG was another company, so there were, if you look at the security space, especially consumer security space, there were the traditional players, using the non-freemium model, and then there were freemium players, and the biggest two freemium players were Avast and AVG. And we basically, a year ago, what we did is that we acquired AVG and combined the two businesses, now being under one same umbrella, and also sharing all the technology and sharing all the user base. And I'll explain later why the user base is so important. If you look at the two companies, they were actually quite similar. They originated from the same country. Both Avast and AVG actually, were founded in the Czech Republic. But they also had a very loyal free user base, about 200 million each, so in total 400 million. They have a very dedicated and very high-performing research and development teams. So by combining these together, we kind of get to synergies that we really kind of believe helped us to take the product to the next level and somehow serve the customers better. Any questions so far? Okay.
No.
So I mentioned 400 million users globally. Now that number obviously sounds very big, but I would like to put it into some context and maybe compare it with some perhaps better known brands or services on the internet. So I would start with Pokemon Go, which was a big hit last year, somewhat this year also, newspapers writing about it all the time, etc. But even in the heyday, Pokemon Go only had about 47 million users worldwide, or players. So that's kind of like a one-tenth of the Avast thing. But even like the bigger, much better known brands eBay or Amazon or Twitter even, their user bases are generally smaller than the Avast user base. So it kind of tells you about the scale that we have built over the years. And also, where we have built in and out, why this is important, especially for the core security technology, I will explain momentarily. Now you might be asking 400 million users where they are. By far the largest pocket or group of users we have in North America, that is Canada and US combined, so about 64 million, followed by Brazil, where we have about 50 million, so very big.
Only in Brazil
it's 50 million. And followed by France with about 21, and then Russia with 20, all the big European countries like UK, Italy, Spain, all these are very significant for us. We also have 20 million users in India, China is probably the only kind of weakness that we have globally, where we only have about 2 million users in China. I mean, 2 million sounds okay, but I mean, given the size of the market, it's obviously very small. The reason for that is not that we don't want to do China, but it's a very regulated market in China. So to sell security software, you actually have to be going through all the authorizations from the communist government, and it's very, very regulated. Basically, none of the international players was able to somehow penetrate the Chinese market. So it's really occupied and somehow, controlled by the domestic players. Now in Mexico, we have 13 million users. I already mentioned that. About 9 million of those are on the PC, and 4 million are mobile devices. So globally, number one by far, 400 million, no one comes even close. The second largest player would be something like 100 million. So we are four times larger in terms of user base than anyone else. The combination, by the way, is coming from PC and from mobile, or from desktop and mobile. The 400 million, we have about 250 on PC and about 160, 170, 180 on mobile. So that kind of makes the split. So PCs or PC plus Mac is still larger than mobile, but mobile is actually growing faster. Now let me talk a little bit about the threats and what's happening in the ecosystem. First of all, the amount of threats or the amount of risks that people are facing online is increasing and has been actually increasing since the beginning. It's not only the absolute numbers. This chart showed the absolute numbers of threats that we have registered over the last, I don't know, 6-7 years. So we can see, and these are millions. So the blue bar is mobile threats, and the white bar is PC or desktop threats. So on the PC, you can see that in 2016, it was actually over 500 million unique threats that we registered just across our user base. And on mobile, it was about 17 million. So 17 million compared to 585, it is smaller, much smaller, but it's also, mobile is also growing faster. So mobile grew by about 60-70%. While PC grew by about 20. But still, it is, I mean, these are huge numbers. You just kind of realize how much of this is happening. And I mean, it's going to only increase. Also, the sophistication of these threats are increasing. And really the only explanation for all of this is that the motivation of the bad guys have changed from some hobbyist or from some people who just wanted to do pranks online, etc., to actually making a lot of money. So it became, cyber has become a normal category of crime, organized crime, which actually, according to the FBI estimate, is now totally on par in size with drugs, with human trafficking, etc. So it is one of the major worldwide major categories of crime, and clearly it is reflected in the numbers. So what we tried actually here is to pinpoint or focus on five specific things that we have seen across over the last year or so, which we feel like the most kind of emerging threats or most important. So I'll be talking a little bit about IoT and what we are seeing in this regard. Then I'll talk about mobile and specifically the mobile threats that are impacting consumers and businesses. Then the third thing, I can't ignore ransomware. Especially after all this, what happened in May and June this year with WannaCry, etc. So I'll talk about this. Fourth, I will also talk about data breaches and what's happening in terms of people losing their accounts or their passwords online. Last but not least, I also talk about a threat that specifically targets small businesses, because we also see small businesses being very much kind of in danger lately. So first of all, IoT. What happened in the last years, I think, is that the IoT revolution, after many years of talking about it, is actually coming. That is, people started, I mean, even in the mainstream, normal individuals at homes started connecting more and more devices to their networks. So, and these devices are not just, you know, regular computing devices like computers, mobile phones, printers, etc., but they are actually new devices, be it, you know, baby monitors, be it cameras, security cameras, be it coffee machines, be it refrigerators, etc. And we'll be seeing much, much more of this. Now, the thing is, I mean, when it comes to security, the IoT devices almost universally are very, very poor when it comes to their security status. The reason I have for this is, you know, the companies who make these devices, they have been in their, you know, home markets, say fridges or TVs or toasters for maybe 50 or 100 years, but they never had to deal with internet or software. Now all of a sudden, the market is pushing them into connecting the devices to the internet, but they don't really have the expertise or the budget to do it properly. So these companies usually aren't very, I mean, good or very experienced in writing software, not to mention in security. And since profit margins are so low in these categories, like, I mean, home appliances, the profit margins of these companies are extremely low. They are pushed on margin. So any other investment, additional investment in things like security, which may sound kind of disposable or not that important, are almost impossible for economical reasons. So we have a situation where millions and millions of new devices are thrown to the market every year, but their security status kind of reminds, you know, the computers in the 90s. Like, it is so easy to find vulnerabilities in these devices.
Yeah. What is the meaning of IoT?
IoT, Internet of Things. I should have explained it quicker. Internet of Things, which is kind of a general term for the people connecting or companies connecting devices that are not computers or not mobile phones to the internet.
Exactly.
So what we did here is basically run a small kind of study here specifically in Mexico, just trying to find out what is the, you know, vulnerability or security status of the devices that are present here. And we found that about 20% or 1 in 5 of every device connected, every IoT device connected to the internet here in Mexico has a known vulnerability that we are able to identify. Now that doesn't mean that there are no other vulnerabilities. There may be more vulnerabilities that we don't know about yet, but just the known ones, already 20% of them are vulnerable. So, I mean, the absolute number can be actually even higher. Now, with webcams, or, I mean, cameras, not necessarily just webcams, but all the cameras, security cameras, etc., together are about 14% vulnerable. Vulnerability here typically means that anyone can be watching what is kind of being recorded on the camera. So the camera is accessible from the internet and can be somehow easily hacked into, so that the attacker can then misuse the camera and see what happened. And also printers, about 1.5 is happening here. Now, one thing to note is that perhaps the most important of all the home kind of IoT devices is what we call the router. And the router is a very specific category of devices which people actually get from their ISPs or that they use to connect to the internet, but they don't necessarily, you know, think about those things that they think they need. I mean, it's this modem or router that people get and usually close it somewhere in the closet. They don't want to worry about it. So the problem here is that if there's a vulnerability in the router and the router is getting attacked or getting hacked into, then all the other devices that connect to the internet through the router are automatically also, you know, infiltrated or are also somehow attacked. Because the router basically controls all the network communication that flows from the network. And so it's extremely important to protect the router. And what's happening is that many of these routers are actually, you know, more vulnerable than So I mean, here in Mexico, in our scan, we basically found that 70% of routers are basically, you know, not secure. That is, that we don't use any kind of encryption. But 6% are vulnerable to a well-known attack. So these cases can be kind of easily targeted by the hacker from the internet. And also, you know, the administrative interfaces that exist in the router, most people don't even know about them, even though they can be exploited to do better. It's kind of not very surprising. It's also kind of got to do with the whole kind of firmware situation. I mean, you have the routers are sort of computers like everything else, but what's happening is that these, when a vulnerability is found, typically the vendor of the device somehow performs a new firmware update, but it is up to the responsibility of the consumer to actually apply this update. People don't do that. Actually, 90%, in our study, we found that to 90% of users never apply the update because they do not even know about it. And again, I mean, all these things basically mean that the it's extremely easy for the bad guy to infiltrate the internal network and somehow do the harm, even though the individual devices like the PC and mobile can be protected. And this is a new phenomenon. Like, I mean, it's been kind of created over time, where the devices, more and more devices are getting connected. Like me at my home, I have, I think, about 32 devices. I counted them about a month ago. And that number will only go up. I mean, people just don't realize how many devices are connected these days. Now, I have Steffi here, who will actually show a small kind of demo of a hack of a smart TV. So we've got a smart TV here, which is basically, what's here. I mean, Steffi would be in her living room. Watching a TV, but all of a sudden the TV can actually kind of be broken into. This is a normal hotel TV, and what we are doing here is that actually we are hacking. Steffi had a script that broke into the router that we have here. The router is vulnerable. It's a vulnerability that allows Steffi as a hacker to actually get into the network from outside, from the internet, and then affect the TV, even though the TV here, we didn't hack into the hotel TV because it's not our TV and we don't want to. It's just a demo on the TV. But the router is ours and the hack happens on the router.
Underneath side. The table somewhere. Like underneath.
What?
The router, it's underneath.
Yeah, the router is somewhere here.
Do you know if that was the way the Russians
It's not clear.
Can you repeat the question?
Yes.
Andre, you repeat it.
I will repeat the question. The question is whether this was the way that the Russians broke into Hillary Clinton's email during the campaign. My answer is that it is not known what happened there. We don't have enough intelligence on this specific case. I don't frankly know. I mean, it could have been a hack like this. It could have been did something different. I don't know. So that was for IoT. The second thing is mobile. Mobile threats are, rising much more than desktop. And what it means is that the bad guys, the bad actors, are actually kind of switching their tactics. They see that people are moving more and more to mobile devices. They use them for email, they use them for web browsing, but they also use them for banking and shopping online. So that's a big opportunity for them to steal money, to steal accounts, etc. So their tactics, the bad guys, are also starting to focus on mobile much more than they used to. They finally realize that it is a big potential for them. And so again, the increase that we registered just in 2016 was over 60%. compared to some 20% increase on the desktop. And that's, I mean, that's a combination of all sorts of tactics they use. On mobile, many of the attacks don't take form of a virus. So it's not like you would have an iPhone and the attacker would infect or upload a virus to your iPhone. That's not really common. But what is common is that the attacker somehow infiltrates the network that the iPhone connects to. So either the Wi-Fi network that the iPhone uses, or the 3G network that you know connects the cellular network. But the effect is the same. They are basically able to filter out the communication that goes back and forth from the device and somehow do what they need to do, which is usually steal accounts or steal money from the individual. Now, one thing to note here is that in talking about broader security, I mean, it's not only about, you know, I mean, just kind of hard security in the sense that, you know, account breaches or viruses, etc. I mean, we kind of tend to take a more holistic look at the situation. And we also realize that mobiles today kind of change how children or kids use technology. I mean, most kids get their first smartphone at the age of 6, 7, 8, and it's a device that they basically can't live without. I mean, they take to their beds and they wake up with, and they have kind of all the time. Which, on one hand, is fantastic that they have all of a sudden access to, you know, all sorts of information, otherwise, you know, unavailable, and the wealth of the internet is great for education. But at the same time, it has some risks, especially for children. And so it is really important that you know, security companies like ourselves come up with solutions that somehow try to, you know, address these issues and address the specific you know, problems that children have in terms of, you know, location, in terms of access to unsuitable content, etc. So I'll show later how, I mean, we are addressing with some of the products that we have. Number three, ransomware. Ransomware, obviously, I mean, made big news in May when WannaCry broke out, but it's nothing new. Ransomware has been here for at least 5 years, if no more. And actually in 2016, it more than doubled in volume. I think about 105% increase just in 2016. And from what I have seen this year, I think 2017 will be even higher growth than 100% growth. So it's more than doubling every year now. And it's a huge problem. It's actually, you know, today, we believe it is the number one category of threat or problem, security problem on the desktop. At all. Now the interesting thing is, I mean, if you look at the absolute numbers, you see something like 128 million attempts to infect computers with ransomware, which is just, I mean, a huge number. I mean, given that the average ransom asked by ransomware today is about $500, this is US, it's actually translates to something like $64 billion that we're asked in ransom. Now, in a study that FBI published last year, it was a US only study, but FBI basically announced that they counted that just in the US, the amount of ransomware paid was over $1 billion. And then, of course, I mean, much, much more wasn't paid, but the attacks still happened and people lost their data. And there's a huge, I mean, I could be talking about ransomware for 2 hours at least, because there's a lot of stuff going on. One of the things here is that the business model is changing. Like, I mean, it's actually the bad guys, I mean, act as professional businesses in the sense that, I mean, you have ransomware as a service, so you have like a distribution model for ransomware. So, I mean, if you want to be in the ransomware business, you actually don't have to employ any, you know, developers or any hackers. It's all readily available. You can just act as a ransomware, you know, distributor for someone else. Also, you know, the tactics, like, instead of just asking for money to be paid, like we have seen, for example, like where they give you option, you either pay the ransom or you infect three other people, and you will get the decryption key for your files back. So it's like all sorts of social, you know, method that they try to use. It's just a very sophisticated segment these days. The new thing also is doxing. Doxing is a new trend where basically instead of, you know, encrypting all the files and asking for a decryption key to, you know, to prevent loss of the data, they actually threaten the user by taking all the files and uploading them to the internet, to public sources, like uploading them to, you know, Facebook, to you know, public Dropbox, etc., and then making all your data available to anyone to see and to download, which again for many people is sort of scary. So it's just a different tactic in which they are trying to get the money from the victim. If you don't pay your private data, which includes pictures and videos, will be published on the internet in relation to your name. So I mean, these things are happening. It's a pretty nasty business. Our products are totally in the business of protecting customers against these things. And I mean, we see it as a high priority for us that, I mean, we really excel in ransomware blocking and ransomware removal. Now, just a few words about WannaCry. I mean, Avast was one of the very few security companies that actually prevented WannaCry from the beginning. That is none, I mean, we've got 400 million users and zero of them were affected or impacted by WannaCry. Great accomplishment. That cannot certainly be said by about many, many other vendors. Now, globally, we detected about 1.75 of a million attempts to, you know, infect machines of our users by WannaCry. Again, none of them succeeded, but anyway, we blocked all of them. But the difference, you may be wondering why WannaCry was so successful, even though ransomware isn't new. The real reason was that WannaCry wasn't like a traditional virus in the sense that you would have to, you know, open email attachments or you would have to click links to get it. It was what we call internet warm, which basically means that it spread from one computer to another fully automatically. Like there was no interaction needed from humans. You didn't have to do anything, but still your machine would be impacted if it wasn't, you know, properly patched. So it used a vulnerability in Windows, which was actually, documented, and a patch was available for more than 2 months before WannaCry struck. But still, there are many, many millions of machines across the world that somehow didn't have the patch installed, and that enabled the propagation of the malware. Not just in consumers, but in businesses. Big companies like the NHS in the UK, that is the largest hospital network in the UK, Telefonica in Spain, the Russian Minister of Interior, etc. Sort of like big institutions were impacted by WannaCry. And also many small businesses, of course. Now what's worrying a little bit is that even today, I mean, I think this study is very new. There is at least 2 million machines in Mexico that still have the vulnerability unpatched. We ran a probe across the Mexican IP address, and there's still like 2 million machines that have this exact vulnerability used by WannaCry, which still the people didn't, you know, bother to install the update for whatever reason. So it kind of, you know, asks for more WannaCry to come. And of course, I mean, this is the only vulnerability that there is maybe many more. Okay, now I'd like to talk a little bit about account breaches or people's kind of online behaviors when it comes to passwords and the security of their accounts. Now, you probably see, I mean, many of you have seen the kind of, you know, announcements of, you know, some of the largest online companies, basically that they got hacked, like Adobe got hacked and Yahoo got hacked, especially in the US. Also many of the retailers, and people, millions of email addresses, millions of passwords, etc., being somehow stolen by hackers and then being being made available publicly on the internet for anyone to see. Now, there's not much you as a user or businesses can do to prevent this. Like, I mean, there's literally, I mean, if you have an account on Yahoo and someone hacks into Yahoo, there's not much you can do to protect against that unless you work for Yahoo and you kind of have the responsibility of their network. But what you can do and what makes a huge difference is whether you actually know about the hack happening and somehow take an action afterwards. So this is where it's so important to kind of, you know, use proper tools that not only kind of tell you that something like that happened, but also kind of, you know, make sure that you do the best you can do to remedy the situation. Like, for example, the critical thing here is that when you use the same password, I mean, don't use the same password on all the accounts, right? If you do, then at least you have to make sure that if some account like this, account breach like this happens, then it actually gets changed across the other, you know, accounts as well. Because again, I mean, if you have a same password on Yahoo and on Facebook, someone breaks into Yahoo, then of course the first thing the attacker will do is use that same password also on other services like Google and Facebook. And in many cases it works. In Mexico specifically, when we surveyed a panel of users, basically 41% of people who use the same password on multiple accounts would say that they wouldn't change the password even after a breach happened. So that's a big concern here. Now, you know, unless you use a good tool to manage the password, it's really difficult because, like, with password complexity requirements, like, of those going up, you can't really remember in your head, like, you know, 5, 10, 20 different passwords, or have them written on a sheet of paper also isn't great. So what really people need is some kind of effective way to manage passwords. And that's where a password manager comes into play. And again, I mean, the study also included the password quality, that is the complexity of the password, and we found some, you know, interesting numbers there. So you'll find all the details in the press kit. I mean, there's a full result of the survey. This is just an example of some of the results. It's quite interesting also to compare the Mexican numbers to other regions. I think these numbers are one of the worst, you know, in the world. But then the IoT numbers, for example, are slightly better. So it's kind of interesting to see where this is.
So, excuse me, these figures are based on your own users, Mexican users, or?
Yes. So let me repeat the question. The question is whether the study was done on Mexican users specifically. Yes, we did run the study in key regions, including Mexico, and then we have it split by countries. So you can kind of compare the Mexican numbers to, for example, US numbers or French numbers or Brazilian numbers. The last thing is SMBs. I think SMB is traditionally a segment. SMB stands for small and medium businesses. That's a segment that's usually quite difficult to manage because, I mean, these are companies, these are kind of corporate business users, but at the same time, they usually don't have the sophistication of running their own IT or IT security department. So they don't have the people to manage security for their internal network. They somehow rely either on some, you know, external help, or they just kind of work the same way as consumers, which may kind of, I mean, create a whole new set of new risks, because the products, I mean, quite frankly, the consumer level products are not 100% suitable for SMBs. And so what SMBs are facing, ransomware is again, like, totally big pick for SMBs. Actually, more SMBs than consumers are now getting targeted by ransomware. But also, the larger the company is, the more likely it is to be somehow, you know, infiltrated by what we call APT or targeted attacks. That is, someone, the attacker, not you know, spreading a virus or a threat kind of, you know, globally, or trying to just kind of distribute it across the board, but actually, you know, creating a custom attack that will only work or that's only designed for that one specific target. And of course, the consumer level products may not be that good at covering those because they are just designed to cover the consumer threats. The other thing, patch management is a huge issue in SMBs. Again, there's no dedicated staff that would take care of providing updates or applying patches, and managing all these, not just the Windows operating system, but all the other systems or the other applications installed, is a big problem. So I'm getting to a stage where I'm basically like to talk about what we do to address these issues. I mean, first of all, we think that you can't really rely on one single point. Security today has to be holistic. We tend to look at it as a sort of circle where you have multiple components. You have the on-device protection, that is, you have something that has to protect against viruses locally on the endpoint. But you also have some kind of network level protection that addresses some of the things I was talking about. The IoT stuff is totally new and requires new sets of products to deal with. Also physical security, especially when it comes to things like the kit issues I was talking about, is very much needed. And the list goes on. So, at Avast, we tend to think about the problem as how can we kind of tackle the entire security landscape? How can we somehow help our customers and help our users to protect in this increasingly complicated world in a way that, as I started, is simple and somehow seamless so that people don't have to worry about it. So before I get to kind of introduce the product portfolio, last thing is I'd like to talk a little bit about the core security technologies that we have at Avast, that we have developed over time, which is related to artificial intelligence and machine learning. I mean, these are big buzzwords these days, but frankly, this is something that we have been using for many years. And the reason for this is that with the increased complexity and volume of threats and also the user base, it's really not possible anymore to scale up with just human force. So in the traditional model, like this would be the traditional security company, you would have basically this loop where new threats would be somehow identified, and there would be human analysts that would somehow create detections. And then they would be sent out to the entire user base with some delay. So it's a reactive approach. It's some kind of approach that doesn't really scale, and it's also inherently very slow because the human element kind of introduces delays. So it doesn't really work in the world that we live in, especially with really kind of big ransomware campaigns. I mean, they typically require something very fast. So our approach, the kind of AI approach, is very different. The approach is that we basically use the user base as a security sensor network. So the point of the software that's running at our users' computers or mobile phones, etc., is not only to protect the device, but also to somehow watch out for suspicious behaviors or for some things that somehow don't look right, and report them back to the cloud, to the giant engine that we run in the cloud, which then allows us in real time to make decisions whether this is normal, this is anomalous, this is good or bad, and somehow immediately after make that decision, inform the rest of the user base about the decision. So it's much faster and it's also much more scalable. Now, yeah.
What is AAIA?
Yes. So IA is artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence. And so when you use AA is machine learning, and machine learning is a kind of subcategory of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is kind of computer science, part of computer science, and machine learning is a one specific subset of artificial intelligence, where you basically, instead of writing programs algorithms that tell the computer how to decide in various situations, you actually feed the computer or the machine learning system with a lot of data that you somehow label as good or bad, and then in the future the computer is able to make decisions automatically without updating the program, just based on the historical data that it has. And here it really kind of becomes more obvious why the giant user base that we have, the free user base that we have, is so important for us. Because ultimately security with machine learning and with AI is all about big data. It's all about how well we are able to get data and process them. The only reliable way to get data, quality data, is really just to have many, many millions of probes out there that constantly look at what's happening on the internet. And again, 400 million, which is like 40% of the installed on all PC, really give us the visibility that we need to kind of tackle even the most advanced and latest threats. Avast and AVG would be the first to see a new threat at the moment it emerges. And that's really what kind of sets us apart and also enables to kind of invest much more in the AI technologies than most other players. This is really very, very important for us. And then even with AI, you would have different layers of protection also. I mean, the technology is very complicated, of course. I mean, our mantra, our mission is to kind of package it in a way which is transparent, which is kind of seamless for the user, so they don't have to worry about all of this. I am just kind of trying to showcase some of the technology advancements and benefits of our engine, which is really kind of reliant on the size of the user base. Cyber capture is a new technology that we have developed in the last years, which is basically, allows us to isolate the kind of latest, the newest files in a very kind of lockdown environment where it can't do any harm, and then we make sure it's not released until and find a decision whether it's good or bad. Okay, so we've got here. So basically, I talked about many risks, about some technologies that allow us to mitigate or address those risks. But what we have here is that, as a kind of result of our effort, about 800 engineers that we employed at Avast is a product that is very, very simple to use. This is Avast 2017. We'll be releasing Avast 2018 at the end of the year. For the next, but all the threats that we talked about, including IoT, so we have an IoT called Wi-Fi Inspector, which is a scan that allows you to identify vulnerabilities in IoT devices. You've got an integrated password manager that allows you to make sure that your passwords are high quality and they are actually unique across various services. We have an integrated ransomware shield, which is extremely powerful against the latest ransomware, etc. And so all these things are packaged in a way that is super easy to use and just kind of install and forget type of thing. This is available both free and paid. There are some meaningful differences between the free version and the paid version. But the basic functionality that I talked about, including protection against all malware, including ransomware, etc., is even in the free product. Now, in parallel with that, there is AVG 2017. And even though the products look different, and they are all different, I can tell you the engine and the internals are the same. So what we did is when we acquired AVG, we actually took all the technologies from AVG from the AVG engine that we found were kind of incremental to the Avast technologies, and we merged them together. And so what you see here is basically a combination of the power of the two engines that kind of, you know, were married. And now the same engine powers both the Avast product and the AVG product. So we both of these kind of product lines get the benefit. And you may be asking why we are keeping both Avast and AVG in parallel, even though the engine is the same. The answer is that it's just brand. In some countries of the world, AVG actually is the stronger brand. Like for example, in the UK, AVG is much better known than Avast. So we are not in the position of kind of, you know, discontinuing the AVG brand because there's a lot of equity in the brand. But otherwise, in terms of technology, we plan to, you know, continue with the unified engine. And then the first thing is the SMB product line. It's actually very, very topical now because just yesterday we released a whole new product line for SMBs. We call it Avast Business. It is, I mean, again, the combination of the Avast and AVG engine. It's brand new. Again, yesterday was the official launch day. And now we'll be kind of, you know, in the process of migrating the legacy both Avast and AVG customers, SMB customers, to this new product. It also has many integrated, you know, extras, like the password management functionality is part of this. And we also are heavily invested in helping MSPs or managed service providers to manage networks. So we have specialized tools for remote management and monitoring. Somewhere here. So the managed workplace product that is part of this is the thing that the MSPs use to manage the security of their clients. Okay, so the last thing I have here, a little bit on mobile. I mean, unlike on the PC, the mobile situation, we have a kind of whole set of products. We decided, instead of kind of creating a Swiss Army knife or a bundle of all the functionality on the mobile, we actually have like a whole array of tiny little apps that you can mix and match. We have all sorts of security related, but also kind of utility related. So all the cleanups and battery savers, etc. Also, we call kind of life hacking, which would be, you know, utilities that help you find public Wi-Fi hotspot, etc., etc. So it's a whole array of tools that we have come across. But now, when it comes to core mobile security, one of the innovations that we have is that we realized that many of the threats on mobile actually cannot be very reliably, addressed by installing just an app on mobile. Like especially on the iPhone, because of the limitations of the operating systems, it's not really possible to prevent attacks by just, you know, installing a security app on the iPhone. And so if you want to do that, you need a different approach. And that approach needs to go much, much deeper. So there's really only two options. One is to go to the hardware level, which is what we started doing with Qualcomm. We now have an exclusive partnership with Qualcomm, where we have a joint project the new Qualcomm chips. Qualcomm is the manufacturer of the mobile chips, of the mobile CPUs. And so we have a joint project, security project with Qualcomm that we are actually, you know, allowing Qualcomm to use the machine learning models right in the silicon level, that is on the CPU, helping to address threats like that. And the second is that we have an exclusive partnership with mobile carriers that actually allow us to kind of work on the carrier network level. So instead of pushing the security module to the endpoint, we have it installed on the carrier network, so that we don't allow any of the bad stuff in by sitting there. And that's really much, much more powerful than what you can do on the endpoint. Right now, we only do this in the US. So US is our kind of home market for this. We have partnership with all four carriers in the US, AT&T, Verizon, Sprint, and T-Mobile. This year, we are going to, you know, take this same technology and same offering outside of the US, including to Latin America. We've got some, you know, good progress in negotiating some of these partnerships. And it's kind of, it's what we think is the future of mobile security. So instead of kind of having apps or agents installed on the device, it will be more running on the carrier level. So customers won't have to worry about, you know, installing security. It will just be enabled by kind of having the filtering done on that level. Okay, so that's really it from my side. Now I would like to open it to questions. I mean, so far you haven't had many questions. Sure.
Well, I have.